This is going to be a little down tempo here. When I proposed this talk, it was really based on a lot of experience that I have working with Cassandra. And so this is really just more of a basic class. I just wanted to give you a warning. This is not an advanced class in building an application. It's really that I heard in the last session somebody saying, how do we even start? Well, this is what I hope we can get accomplished in this talk. So, all right, so this is me. My name is Patrick McFadin. I'm the chief architect at Hobsons, a company not a lot of you have probably heard of unless you work at DataStax. And we're an education services company. You probably will hear of us if you go to college and or have gone to college in the past few years. We do things like college applications, online college applications, recruitment, that sort of thing. My primary focus as chief architect is really about performance and scaling. And believe me, whenever you're filling out a college application, the last thing you want to see is something that doesn't scale or perform. So I've been using Cassandra since about 0.7. It was, I think, February of 2011 or 2000. It was at Cloud Connect, and Adrian Cockcroft gave this talk about how he was using Cassandra. And so we started talking. He's like, you really should try it based on your use case. And I got hooked. I went home that night, and man, I just couldn't stop. I loved it ever since then. So that was 0.7. Now with 1.1 out, it's really epic. So it's just getting better and better. And of course, my gratuitous Twitter handle. So here's what we're going to do today. We're going to take a concept, an application concept. We're going to answer the first question that comes out of every developer's mouth, is what's the data model? How am I going to put this in the data model? And I'm not going to try to give you like the biggest scope of this. We're going to try to narrow it down some. But the data model is always the big problem, right? Because how am I going to persist this data in my database? And Cassandra is different from MySQL. We've all used MySQL, I'm sure, or Postgres, or Oracle. We all know a lot about relational data models. When you go through any kind of programming class and you do a database, it's probably going to be something like that. So this is kind of a new form of thinking, although you'll find it's not that new. I have some sample code that I'm going to be using. I did everything in Java in this particular case. And I have some homework for everybody. I used to teach at college, so it's kind of something I can't get out of my system. So the homework is completely optional. I put my code up in GitHub. You can have fun implementing it. I know there's some people who like to work from examples, so I've made that available. All right, so here's what we're going to do. We're going to take that new application. We're going to have that whiteboard session in a few seconds. I'll pre-optimize the whiteboard session. So we're going to identify entity tables. That's one of the first things you do with a relational model. But then we're going to do something a little different. We're going to identify query tables. And that's kind of the new thing that we're going to add to this discussion. We're going to do some coding, very little coding, and keep going and keep going. So we're going to get the minimum viable product out there. And then we're going to do a deployment. And yes, I'm going to do this in 30 minutes. And it's up to you, and then you get a profit, right? So that's the point. All right, so here was my concept. Killervideo.com. This is my Hacker News, my weekend project. And so it's really a unique idea. I don't think anyone's ever thought of this, and that's sharing videos on the internet. It's going to have the same stuff that you normally would expect, the title, the description for the video. And there's my cute little cat picture, cat video. I'm going to have ratings. I'm going to have tags and comments. People are going to, it's a user concept, so I'm going to be able to view or upload and view those things and track that viewing. So I mean, it's going to be cool, right? I mean, no one ever thought of this, right? Well, probably not. So, and by the way, killervideos.com, I registered that, so don't even try. So, I don't know what I'm going to do with it, but I just registered it. It was 10 bucks. So, all right, here's what we're going to do is break down the features. This is the first step of any application design. Is we're going to say, okay, what are all the features? And this is when your product manager sits there and tries to add to that list, and you say no, right? Remember that? So we're going to, of course, these are easy ones. We're going to post a video, we're going to view a video, add comments, rate a video, tag a video. Those are our feature sets for this. And because I'm doing this at my house on the weekend, I don't get to hear the product manager tell me that there's 10 more features that have to be in there or no one will use it. I put in a very, very small text at the bottom. I'm not going over transcoding, but you can use Zencoder. Zencoder is really cool. I have used that. All right, so here we go. The real fun starts with the entity tables. This is your basic storage unit. This is it. This is where you start with your application design. And this is where we've all started probably with most of them, with users, right? Every user-based system has a table called users or something like that. These are very similar. These tables in Cassandra would be very similar to what you would do in a relational database. You have an ID, or a row key in this case, which would be username, and then all the columns would be just like fields in your database. And this is a pretty simple table. And I'm going to use the, I think I put the warning out there, but I'm going to use the word table and column family kind of interchangeably. But tables is fine, because that's really what it is, a table of data. So I want to say that for a feature of my system, username is unique. So what I'm going to do is make username the row key, guaranteed to be unique. It's also going to be indexed automatically since it's a row key. That's good, because I'm probably going to do a lot of username lookups. Now, the secondary indexes, now this is what you would classically put just indexes in your database on a relational database, I'm going to put that maybe on the first name and last name. And that'll let me do lookups based on, say, a last name equals blah or first name equals blah. The secondary indexes are pretty effective in that case. And because this is, quote unquote, schema free, I'm going to be able to add columns to this pretty easily. I think I've seen some demos where they've actually had, for different users, they've had different column names, but we're going to try to keep it fairly static in this case. I put a little bit of CQL down here to create that table. In the demo that's on GitHub, I actually did it all in Cassandra CLI. I should put the CQL version up there as well. That's CQL 2 and 3. Yes, there's two versions, so I'll try to get that up there soon. So here's some code, and I'm not going to try to get, this is not how to program using Hector and Java, but that's what this is Java using the Hector library. Now, that is really tiny. okay, those of you with the binoculars, you can probably see this. The easy way to describe this is that what's different and what's similar. And if you've done database programming, the similarity is you create something to operate against the database, like a prepared statement in JDBC. But in this case, you create a mutator. And that's not something that Perry the Platypus would stop. A mutator is something that operates on a Cassandra database. And in this case, I'm just going to do a simple insertion. And the row key for each one of those insertions is going to be the username. So if one person, one username, I'm going to have each column is enumerated in an insertion. You create this mutator with the insertion, bam, do an execute, and that writes it into your database. So Cassandra then will get that code and say good to go. Now, the get part, I left that on GitHub if you want to try that. We're going to do it. We're going to look at a getter here in a minute. But this is a very simple operation of just setting a record in the database using a username. And that is probably the first one that you want to try. So the next obvious one is videos. And this case is a little different because the row key is not going to be unique. And that's because I'm probably going to have the same name of video out there, right? I mean, that's my cool cat video. It's probably going to be something that will happen over and over again. Or kids playing. So we want to be able to say, okay, you can have non-unique username or video names. So in this case, I'm going to use something that is guaranteed to be unique. Now, a relational database is one of the things about a distributed database, which is a real pain, is how do you do a sequence? Well, we don't have to worry about that as much. We're just going to use UUID. UUID is guaranteed to be unique. It's a type that's on Cassandra, which is great. And we can use that for our row key. Perfect. So again, similar to the way user was, we're going to create these static columns where we're going to have a username that updated or that uploaded the video, description, and tags. Now the tags, in this case, I put a note in there. This is where you can get creative with your column value. The column name is tags, but the value. Now, we just saw Jonathan talk about this, which is really exciting, about collections that are going to be available in 1.2. That might be a good place for this. In this case, what I did is I just created a simple delimited list, a common delimited list of tags. But I think collections would be a great case for that. Now, you could put up secondary indexes, but I put on username. Now, username is probably not the best thing to index and use a secondary index on. And that's because of the high cardinality issues with Cassandra secondary indexes. It's probably going to be pretty unique. I don't think they're going to have a lot of people updating or uploading a ton of videos. Let's say if you have because our website is going to be so killer, it's going to have a million videos on it, and it's possible, you know, with the 4 million users that we have, it's going to be pretty unique. The username will be unique. So we don't want to put a secondary index on there. That presents a different problem that we will solve in a minute. Again, here's the CQL for that. So here's the get code. Again, very similar to relational databases, we're going to create a some sort of a prepared statement. In this case, we're going to create a slice query. And a slice query, and this is in Hector, is it looks at the way that Cassandra's arranged its rows. So you think about potentially a row could be this really long columns. I mean, you have tons of columns. You could have a million columns. Somebody said a billion last night. I hope not. But you could have a ton of columns. Well, if you don't want to grab all of it at one time, I mean, that could be a really big problem on your application code. So you want to think about this as, I want to grab a slice of this. I want to grab 100 rows of this. Or I want to grab a certain group of these, maybe a certain time span. This is where those time series demonstrations come in really good, because you're slicing out just a piece of those columns. And this is different from what a relational database will do for you. Because a relational database, you throw all these predicates in there. You do the pushdown predicates to get the kind of the summation of data. And then you get back a result set. Well, Cassandra is going to give you a lot more if you ask for it. So just know how to ask. Slice query is where you go. So slice query is very simple for this case, because we're just going to say, I'm going to operate on the videos table. And my row key is the video ID, that UUID. And then I'm just going to say, here's all the column names that I want. And those could be dynamic. As long as that column name's in there, it's going to pull it out. I'm going to execute the query and then just pull out each one of those things from the query and set it into my video object, return the video object back to the user. This is a pretty fast operation, because it's going to be operating directly on the row key. So now we're getting into some of the more interesting ways to use Cassandra, the comments table. Now, this in a relational database may be related to users and videos. You'd have a joiner table. We're not going to do that in this case. What we're going to do is we're going to say, OK, a video has a lot of comments. So when you say they have many comments, it's one to a bazillion. You never know. And that's a number. And the composite columns is where this is going to work. This is denormalization the Cassandra way. And composite columns are when you take one data type and another data type and put those together to make something, combine something. And it makes it unique. So in this case, what I'm looking at is, so the video ID, there's one video, it has a bunch of comments in it. Well, I want to be able to sort that by which user. I also want to be able to put a timestamp in there in case I want to grab like a certain range of times, maybe all the comments from 20 minutes ago. The order is preserved from left to right if you're looking at the column. And that's really cool too, because if I just grab everything, I'm guaranteed some sort of order just because of the way it was inserted into that column. But the get slice is what I talked about before, is really where this comes in handy, because the get slice is going to grab whatever I want based on my predicate. I'd say I want everything that starts with username P. McFadin. And that's going to give just those comments that I put in there. And so, or you could say I want everything from a timestamp start to finish, so like the last 20 minutes or the last hour or something like that. That's where it's going to be the power of that fast query. You're going to look it up on row key, fast, and then a slice, fast, because it's just a string operation, and you're going to get that data back pretty quick. This is very different, because now you have an unbounded amount of columns in your row. And there's the SQL for that. The username is the person who put the comment in, and the timestamp is when that comment was put in. That's the convention. And the value is, of course, the comment, the string. So now rating a video. And I'm using the rating to show off another really cool feature of Cassandra, and that's counters. And in this case, again, every video has a rating. And I'm going to use the video ID again, because that's a really handy, unique situation. And yeah, I'm making sure I'm on time here. Keeping you on lunch. All right, so the UUID for video will be your unique lookup. But then what happens with the counts? Counts are awesome, because it's one operation. You say, hey, I want to increment or decrement this column. One shot. There's no distributed locking that used to be before counters. It's just one deal. And you can increment or decrement by any integer, really, and it just take it up or down or whatever you want to do. So we're going to take advantage of that. So what I did is I created these two columns. One's called a rating count, and that's going to be how many times someone rated it. And then I'm going to have another one that's called rating total, which is the 0 through 5 rating cumulative. So in my example, I had 5 people rate my cat video with a total of 23. So my app logic, I say for my average rating, it's 23 divided by 5. I got a 4.6 rating on my cool cat video. And this is a great thing in your Cassandra toolbox, counters. The unique thing here is that you can only have counters, a counter column, column family. You can't mix counters with some other type. You have to have everything countered. So that's why there's only 2 things in this particular one. But that's fine. They work really well for this. You can have a lot of counters if you wanted to. If you wanted to extend those columns out, that's fine too. I have some data models where I actually have some counts along with timestamps, and those grow unbounded. Those are for like web logs. In this case, we're just going to have a very simple layout. I put the CQL in there, and there's a little asterisk down there. Counters, the create table for that is only available in SQL 3 now, or CQL 3. I can't say SQL, because everyone will think I'm talking about relational data. We've got to come up with something different. So the CQL 3, you can create those. And other than that, you can use the CLI, which I did use. That's in my GitHub. So the video event, all right, do we have any Netflix guys in here? Oh, good, because I totally ripped it off from them. by the way, did anybody see Adrian's demo over there that was epic. He told me about that a couple months ago, and I said, you're going to get burned on that. But it worked. He actually did a live load test by bringing up these SSD instances in Amazon on stage. That was really cool. And I feel totally inferior because I have static slides. Anyway, so I ripped this off from Netflix. But yeah, it was a good idea, right? They should know how to do this. So what I'm going to say now is because what I want to do is someone's viewing a video, I want to track where they are. I want them to be able to walk away from a video, start a cat video, say, oh, it's time for dinner, stop, come back, maybe pull it up on their iPad or their iPhone, and start at the same timestamp again. So how are we going to do that? Well, we need to track these events. So whenever the player registers a start event, it will send it over to Cassandra. We'll insert that start event into this table. And that'll be the first column. Whenever they say, oh, it's time for dinner, they hit stop, I'll create a stop timestamp, and then I'll put the video timestamp for that. And they could do that over and over and over again if they wanted to. When they come back to use the player, all I have to look for is the last stop event, cue the player to that video timestamp, and then they're off to the races. They're watching cat videos right where they left off, and they're pretty happy about my website. So this is a good example of that kind of interesting kind of combinational thing, and that's the row key. It's a video ID and the username, because that's really what the event is. It's this person watching this video. That's a good denormalization. And so what we can get out of this is potentially a very long amount. I mean, if someone who's watching it over and over again, you get to see the stop and start events. But this is also really good for analytics later. Let's say you want to do some analysis, like how many people watched all of the cat video, or how many people watched 5 minutes of the cat video. Well, we can find out. It's available. All right, so the query tables. I'm going to go through these fairly quick because they're pretty self-explanatory now that you're all good at doing Cassandra. So the query table, it reverses kind of a thing that we already got and took advantage of in a relational database, and that is a relation that's quick. So what I'm going to do is I have this problem. I need to look up all the videos that one person has submitted. And with my user table or my videos table, that doesn't make much sense. It's harder. It's going to be a slower query. We want to try to optimize that some. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create this username video index table. So every time someone posts a video, I'm going to put the video ID in there and the timestamp that they did it. That way, if I ever want to say, oh, how many users did, or how many videos did P. McFadin put in here, I can do a get slice and find out all the videos that I put in. Or, hey, you put in, how many did I do last week? And here's a list of all those that I did last week. So this is a second table that would have to be maintained, and that's the key. So now, whenever we put up a video, we're going to have to not only put it in the video, but in the username video index table. And this is one of the first moments where I get that panic look from some developers that I talk to. Is like, dude, you're doing too many writes. Ah, that's Cassandra. Cassandra loves rights, and just put a ton of them on there, and it'll be completely happy. And that is the best thing about Cassandra, is that you no longer have to worry about rights. Relational programmers really are concerned about how many rights I'm putting on the database. Dude, I did like 10. It's crazy. I better optimize that. Oh, you only did 10? That's the Cassandra answer, right? I have one event event stream that's running out of Flume that does 100 inserts for every web event. And it just cooks. It's not a problem, because that is what Cassandra is really good at doing. Same thing with tags. Tags, I want to look up how many videos have a really cool tag, like cat or video cat video. So again, I'm just going to create an index table that says, here's the tag, and then here's the video IDs of all those videos that have that particular tag. And this is where you get into this, okay, you're kind of on your own business, and I know this kind of makes people upset, but you got to maintain this table. If someone removes a tag or removes a video, you have to keep in mind that this table exists. You don't want to have this thing orphaning out a whole bunch of video IDs or a bunch of tags. So this is just one of the things you have to keep in mind. Yes, that's kind of a pain, but this is, you know, you get trade-offs. What is really cool is that it's really hard to bring this database down. And so you can trade that off a little bit. Come on, give a little bit. So all that index integrity, referential integrity is maintained in your application logic. So what about deployment? This is going to be a short and sweet because it's kind of up to you. But let's take it from like more of a philosophical way, which is measuring your risk. Now, you guys probably saw all the Netflix stuff. You know, they're distributing their databases like around the world into like the moon or something, and that's great for them because apparently they're responsible for like 20% of the internet traffic. I guarantee killervideo.com is not that app. And so we're gonna have to measure this out. Now, when Amazon had that outage last month, I think it was, there was a hilarious tweet. It said, yeah, hundreds of startup websites went down that it inconvenienced dozens of users. So, okay. You might be okay with that three-node ring, okay? You don't have to, you know, multi-data center. But again, you look at your risk, and you look at how much money you have in your pocket. If this was my weekend project, I guarantee you I'm not going to be replicating this all over the place. If it goes down for an hour or three or whatever it is Amazon gives me, then I'm going to just put up a little 404 sorry page, fail whale, make it cute, and then I'll be okay. So, but in a case where you do have a lot of users, and this is where the Netflix model comes in, it's like, you know, they have a ton of users and they want to be up all the time, that's available. You can go that way if you want to. So that's how you measure your risk and your deployment. Now the performance, this is the best thing about Cassandra, I feel. This is what got me the most excited. Is I come from an operations background with Oracle, and what happens whenever you go to buy an Oracle server? You're like, I don't know what the load's going to be, but you better buy a big one. I mean, it better be huge, and then if I hope it holds up. And if it doesn't, we got to call Dell, or we got to call Oracle. And Oracle is going to scale right up until you run out of money. And then you can't call their Oracle rep, and you can't scale anymore. So when I think about performance in Cassandra, I'm just like, oh, whatever's good for now. I'll just double my ring later if I need to. And it's all good. And that's what we just saw in that demo that Adrian did. He's like, oh, I think I'll just double my ring. And bam, you can see the performance just drop. And that is really the key here, is you just think about what you need right now, maybe a little more, but you can just always deploy more later. The key, have an expansion plan ready. Do not get caught getting slash dotted. I know that's kind of a dated term anymore. All right, hacker news, that your website just got hammered and you don't have a way to expand your ring. You're not even thinking about it. Oh. Wait a minute, we got to double our ring. How are we going to do that? Get that ready, okay? Use Chef. Have some, you know, do some drills. Get things ready. And once your expansion is needed, just expand it. It'll be awesome. You'll have plenty of scaling. There'll be unicorns and rainbows and, you know. All right, so wrap it up. I'm doing good on this. I'm going to keep you guys right on time. So what I'm trying to impress on you is this is a very similar model, a modeling exercise to relational databases with some twists. And you start out with that same thing, like what am I trying to store here? What are my model of people, videos? But then you start getting into this little more of a Cassandra-esque type discussion, whereas what's my index table? How am I going to look up data? And really it's based on the query. The query is I think I've heard someone say, one query, one table. That's pretty much a one-to-one relationship. And that's really based on your features. And yes, I know you're trying to come up with all your features in the beginning. Don't worry about that. It's easy to backfill sometimes. If you come up with another feature in the next week, you create the table for it, you can take some data, you can dump it in there. It's easy to do. It's just not that, it's not the end of the world if you don't come up with every feature or every query table. You can do it later. So again, do not be afraid to do writes. And that's the index table issue is, oh, wait a minute, I'm going to have to write to 3 tables or 10 tables or 15 tables or 100. Okay, Cassandra can do it. And if it isn't, and if you start running into scaling problems, add another node, add double your ring, whatever. It's going to scale up. Don't be afraid to do writes. So I put the bonus points on here. So now, because if you're using DSE, which is a DataStack enterprise, you can then have access to Hadoop and Solr. Now, what we could do with our video, killervideo.com, is Hadoop would be excellent for the video stream. How many people started videos and didn't stop them? Cool, that's a cool big data analytics thing. Solr running on top of my ring would be awesome for indexing, doing text indexing on my descriptions. So when people search for things that are just kind of buried in the description, quick, nice, easy to use format. I mean, Solr is great for that kind of stuff. There's going to be a talk on Solr specifically about this later, so I would suggest you go see that. But that would be an add to this. So now it's your turn. Here's my GitHub address, P. McFadin. I posted a bunch of stuff this morning. I'm going to continuously do it. You can follow me on GitHub, and you can see whenever I do updates, or just follow me on Twitter. Here's my email address. If you want to send me an email with some solutions or questions or whatever, you can clone it, you can fork it, and implement those stub methods. Go out and play if you want to. Those are for people who really want to play around with it and want to talk about it. I know there's not enough examples out there, and I was trying to provide some, and I'm going to try to do more. I just have the Java and Hector one, and I'm going to try to do Java and AstNax, and also Python. We were talking last night about how the Python would look. Just give you some flavors, some different flavors. And of course, if you want to follow me on Twitter, that's more gratuitous, Twitter, Twitter, Twitter. And that's it. You can have lunch now. Thank you very much.